my name is Beth Luthye. I am the Anti-Trafficking Coordinator for Nazarene Compassionate Ministries. This is Jason Pope, who I'm super excited is here. He works with the Salvation Army World Service Office and oversees all of their anti-trafficking work around the world. This track is set up to move from one session to the next session. So the next session, Jennifer Romhilt-Tunhog is going to be teaching, and that's going to build on this workshop. The next workshop is also going to be a little more specific and build on these two workshops. So they're all free today, and they are encouraging people to sort of go through tracks. You don't have to. You can switch around to all sorts of different topics if you want. But we're in Human Trafficking 101. The next workshop is Church Engagement, which will be more of a workshop style. And then Economic Development as Anti-Trafficking. Then on Friday, we have an expert on trauma-informed care coming in. And then on Saturday, a couple of people who work with a restoration home. So they're going to be talking about specific best practices of aftercare. This session, we're going to go through what is human trafficking, what's the biblical basis, why as the church should we care, why should we do something, how to engage, and a root cause analysis, and then just a little, okay, what's next, and a Q&A. Before we get into it, are there any really specific questions or things that people wanted to learn about? We can include those. Okay, if you have questions along the way, go ahead and jot those down. And I'd like to just open us in a quick prayer. God, thank you for who you are. Thank you for your care for those who are oppressed. Use this time, God, to open our minds that we would learn, open our hearts that we would love, and work those both together so that we could go out and move in action in your name. Amen. So, to borrow a friend's phrase, we're going to ask you to drink from a fire hose during this session. Lots and lots of information. But again, if you do have questions, things you want to follow up with, write those down and we'll get to those at the end. So, human trafficking, understanding trafficking in persons. Definition. Human trafficking is a form of modern slavery where people profit from the control and exploitation of other people. Basically, people are bought and sold. It is modern day slavery. There's a legal definition of trafficking in persons. Anybody have an idea of why it would be important to have a legal definition? Yeah. So in 2000, it's not like anti-trafficking wasn't a thing before the year 2000, but in the year 2000, the UN and the group of people who vote on things came together and created a human trafficking protocol with this definition. Acts plus means equals purpose. So acts being recruiting, harboring, transporting, provisioning, or providing, obtaining, enticing, maintaining, or any attempts to complete these. By force, fraud, or coercion. Force meaning violence. It could also be anything from denying people food, forcing people to become addicted to drugs, any sort of force. Fraud, deception, saying one thing and then not doing it. Coercion, so maybe it's I'm gonna hurt somebody that you love if you don't do X, Y, or Z. So force, fraud, or coercion. For one single purpose, which is exploitation. The two main forms that we'll talk about are sexual exploitation and labor trafficking. So commercial sexual exploitation in any form, whether that's prostitution or sex acts on the internet, on the phone, any sort of sexual exploitation. And then labor trafficking, services, debt bondage as well, when you're born into debt and you can't get out. The exception. Anybody who's a minor the means doesn't matter. If any of these acts happen and you're under 18, you're a minor, and you're exploited for commercial sex, that is human trafficking and that can be prosecuted. Okay, so we have a little quiz. I want you to turn to the person next to you. Don't discuss, but just say true or false. Okay, so true or false, this does not happen where I live. True or false, trafficking always involves women or girls in situations of sexual exploitation. People trafficked in the U.S. are all immigrants. Human trafficking involves transportation or movement across borders. Human trafficking always involves physical restraint, force, or bondage. Victims of human trafficking will ask for help and will self-identify as a victim of crime. Victims always come from situations of poverty or small villages and towns. Human trafficking occurs only in illegal underground industries. If a victim initially consented to be in their situation or was informed about the type of work, then it cannot be considered trafficking because they knew better. Okay, so really you don't need me here. Yeah, so if you answered false to all of these, A plus. There was a survey done recently though where not everybody answered the questions the same way you did. So lots of people think, well, this doesn't really happen where I live. So we're gonna talk about what this looks like around the world, as well as specifically in the United States. If you're from the US, raise your hand. If you're from outside the US, raise your hand. Okay. (clears throat) 152 countries, this is according to the UN's research, 152 countries are source countries for people who are trafficked. 124, and these are just the ones that are known, 124 are destination countries. They found 510 circuits, so these paths of where people are trafficked from and trafficked to. This happens pretty much anywhere. And statistics are hard with human trafficking because we go with what we know, and a lot of it's not known. So the UN will estimate there are about 21 million victims of human trafficking in the world. But then recently, the Slavery Index suggested 46 million. And this isn't necessarily the ones that are counted, but they basically did research and said, okay, if this is true, then we guess that there's probably about 46 million. We can't really know for sure, but there are a lot of people in the world, a lot of people in the world, but there are also a lot of Christians in the world, a lot of church members in the world. So there are things that can be done. I'm gonna show a video. In San Diego, California, which is where I'm from, there's a Nazarene College, Point Loma Nazarene University. Jamie Gates, I'm gonna call you out, is sitting here. He runs the Center for Justice and Reconciliation at Point Loma. They've created a scholarship fund called Beauty for Ashes, specifically for survivors of human trafficking. So I'm gonna show you a little bit of a video of the first student who is a recipient of that scholarship. She's an older student. This is a little bit of her story. It is not necessarily G-rated.
I was out there alone and I got picked up by a guy in a truck. He wanted oral sex. And so while I was doing that to him, I felt him put his hands on my head like he wanted to just crack my neck. He didn't kill me, and I went straight home and I cried myself to sleep. In human trafficking, sometimes I was forced, then I'd realize, wait a minute, I'm making all the money here, I'm doing all the work, so then I would change it and then somebody would, you know, beat me up and trap me in a hotel room for a while, and then, until I could get away from that, and if you're living this life, you want out. There's nothing for you on the other side yet. You want to make him happy, so you do it. And you don't feel like a victim, you feel like he's your partner. We're taking care of each other. That's not the case.
Victims are manipulated into thinking this is a choice they're making in life. Their trauma is so severe. It starts with being molested, child abused, witnessing domestic violence. This exploitation is just another phase of their life where they are just being exploited and manipulated.
When I was 8 years old, my stepdad raped me every day all summer. I thought for many years that I was part of it and that it was my fault. My whole life I've been a victim, and I never really realized that.
What are you drawing?
A train.
This is a social phenomenon with roots in marginalized communities that are lacking in services and where the home environment is very bad. So how can we as a society own that?
We're hoping, and we have seen signs, that the research is also making an impact on policy and what policies the city and also the state will implement, what policies law enforcement will change and shift to.
We're just people. We're just people that were, that, you know, some of us never even had a chance from the very beginning. You know, I mean, we need help.
This is a woman who grew up in the U.S. It happens everywhere. And her story is not really uncommon. However, even though that's what we think about, that's not the only story of human trafficking. So it doesn't just happen to women, it doesn't just happen to girls, and it's not just sexual exploitation. Labor trafficking is a huge part of the picture of human trafficking. So out of the people known, again, with statistics, it's a little hard to say all of these are exactly right. But out of the ones who are known, 49% are women, 21% are girls, 18% are men, 12% are boys. And those numbers shift when you talk about specific types of trafficking. So sexual exploitation, forced labor, other forms, which includes debt bondage, peonage, which is when you're born into debt slavery, child soldiers. Organ removal is also a small piece of the pie. It's important. It's not something that we're going to talk about today. 53% of women and girls are exploited sexually. 40% forced labor, 7% other forms. Then when you go to men and boys, there is a percentage of men and boys who are sexually exploited, and that's a story that we don't talk about a lot, but it is a reality in our world. Forced labor is the biggest part of that pie. Other forms than an organ removal. Oh, wait. I'm sorry. This was everybody. So out of all of it, it's 53% sexual exploitation. Then when you get to women and girls, 79%. 14% forced labor. So women and girls certainly are vulnerable in a different way because of their gender. People trafficked in the U.S. are not all immigrants. Again, that story of Crystal shows she was born exactly where she was and trafficked in her home community. It is not a crime that always includes transportation or crossing borders. Smuggling crosses borders. Trafficking is when there's force, fraud, or coercion for those acts that we talked about earlier. It does not always involve physical restraint, force, or bondage. The psychology is powerful. So the psychological coercion is a huge part of human trafficking. I volunteer with a restoration home in San Diego where I mentor young women who are coming out of sex trafficking. And you know, I was mentoring a young woman and was told, well, she's not really with us anymore. She was sneaking out to see her pimp. And in our minds, that does not make sense. Why would you do that? You got away. The psychology is really strong. And the things that trauma does to the brain are really powerful, and the healing takes a long time, long time. Again, victims of human trafficking don't always self-identify. Sometimes if they come from another country and they're like, well, you know, he told me he was gonna bring me over here for a job, and then he kept me and, you know, paid me 50 cents a day or whatever. They don't always identify that as a crime. Victims always come from poverty situations or small towns. Again, that's a large piece of the story, and something that Jason and Jennifer will touch on later when they talk about economic development. But it's not the only story. It's people from all parts of life. You know, educated, not educated, male and female, foreign nationals and citizens, crosses all racial, ethnic, all lines that you could think of. And it doesn't only occur in illegal underground industries. It's happening in your town. It's happening in hotels. It's happening at nail salons. It's happening. If victims initially consented to be in their situation, then essentially they knew better. But if you get into a situation and you can't get out, that makes you a slave. So that is a reality. Jason's going to talk a little bit about why the church should be involved.
As Beth mentioned, I am from the Salvation Army's World Service Office, and we work with our international, we have local Salvation Armies across the world, 127 different countries. Our office focuses on community development. I just want to make a small clarification. Everything that we do in trafficking is not from our office. There are other counterparts like myself that are supporting work across the world, and also just our local churches are doing work in human trafficking. We did a survey, and 80% came back saying they were doing something in human trafficking. So there's a lot of things that we don't even have an idea about that's going on. We focus more on a project approach, so we have a kind of a bigger viewpoint than maybe what's happening in one local community at times. Just to give you a little more of my background, and also I work with Beth and Jamie both on the Faith Alliance Against Slavery and Trafficking that brings together different organizations and universities, and we are working currently on a individual membership that you could connect with and be able to be a part of some learning calls and also get information and materials. So if you're interested in that, we could talk later. But the biblical basis for church engagement, like was mentioned before, this is a bit of an introduction and like drinking through a fire hose to try to actually address, you know, the biblical basis in the next, say, 10 to 15 minutes would be quite difficult. So we are gonna just try to get an introduction to that. And I'd ask that if you can kind of group yourselves in about five to seven people each in a group, then we're going to look at a passage together in that group. And so go ahead and feel free to kind of rearrange yourself. You need to sit on different rows or pull your chairs in different directions, whatever is convenient. Okay, so I'm going to read a passage that you're probably familiar with. And then I have three questions, which I'll read to you, and you can discuss those questions as it relates to this passage. After I read them, I'll write them on the board over there so that you can reference as you go forward. But the passage is John chapter 4. Jesus talks with a Samaritan woman. Now Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself as did also his sons and his livestock? Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water, welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. He told her, go call your husband and come back. She said, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true. Sir, the woman said, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is Jerusalem. Woman, Jesus replied, believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, and they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, his worshipers must worship in spirit and truth. And Jesus and the woman said, I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. And Jesus declared, I am the one speaking to you. I am he. Now many of the Samaritans, I've skipped down to verse 39, many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the women's testimony. He told me everything I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed for 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. They said to the woman, we no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we've heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world. So here's the discussion points. So first, the theme of the conference, living in the margins. I've had some conversations. I worked with churches for 10 to 12 years. I can't remember exactly. Like I was a support system to churches, and we focused on church growth at times. And I always found this passage a little bit interesting because it was Jesus and the way that he reached. It said many people came to know Jesus, and I was thinking about strategy at the time. And I know that there are at times, you know, these ideas of church growth and of holistic ministry can be at odds with each other, or the camps can be at odds with each other. So the first thing, I guess, is living in the margins. What can you take from Jesus' example? This is not the only example. Can't put our whole trust in this one passage, but what can you take from this? And that relates to living in the margins and a strategy for reaching your communities, or a strategy for engaging your communities. What is the strategy that Jesus is using? Is, I guess, the way I would say it. That would be the first discussion point. The second is how can you? I think there's two. There's slavery, and as Christians, we may process things that we're enslaved to. Even within our life, when we're trying to develop holiness, things that are barriers, spiritual blocks, and we know that Christ wants us to be free or to engage in abundant life, and so we have this idea of slavery. But then there's actual physical slavery. Someone is not able to operate on their own agency or their own free will. They are enslaved physically. So how do those two things relate? In what ways can we tie together physical slavery and spiritual slavery, and looking at this passage? That would be the second question. Third is, how can this passage relate to slavery and fighting slavery in general? How can we apply the theological lessons that we can take from this passage to fighting trafficking? So those are the three questions. I'll write them over here. And if you want to start with the question of strategy to engage your community, you can start with that, and the rest of them will be up there by the time we get there. And we have 10 minutes. Okay. So I know we probably could have spent a lot longer on that, but hopefully we've had some good conversations. I'd love it if you feel like you have something to share. I'd love several people to share concise type of feedback. So is someone willing to share their group's discussion in, say, 60 seconds? Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Well, he just approached her, or she approached him, I guess, but he just... talked to her as if he was talking to anyone that came to the well. It wasn't until after they engaged in a relationship where he even revealed that he knew who she was. But one of the things that stood out for me about the passage was I think it turns our strategies upside down. We think about we need strong leaders, strong leadership, that you know, very influential person in the community. That's the strategy. But really, maybe we're just defining strong the wrong way, right? Like maybe Jesus did pick the strongest person in the community, and she became the champion, right? So she was the voice, and I think it comes back to that verse, you know, the weak things of the world will confound the wise. Like the idea of even victim versus survivor and victim versus champion. I think there's a lot that we can learn from this passage. We have on the PowerPoint, there's a lot of other passages that you can go to. So if you look it up on the website, you can do that. So back to Beth.
I'm going to flip through these. Again, all of these resources will be online so that you can have access to those. Lots of Bible verses about why the church should be involved. And if any of you haven't read, the Church of the Nazarene is part of the Wesleyan Holiness Consortium, which is obviously a consortium of Wesleyan Holiness churches. A couple of years ago, the Wesleyan Holiness Consortium, their Freedom Network, put together a statement, a declaration for freedom. It's on our website, and I'll give you that URL later. But it's really a beautiful, concise picture of why, as Wesleyan Holiness churches, and in much in the vein of what Dr. Busick talked about this morning, why we should be engaged specifically in this issue. Church engagement strategies. Lots of people have lots of different ideas about how they want to personally be involved in this issue. I got an email just this past week, and I don't put this up here as in any way to make fun of this person, but to say this is an honest and sincere email that I received that said, I've been called by God to work with human trafficking victims. My plan is very simple. I have a college friend who currently works with victims overseas. We would work together and organize for the victims to have the opportunity to come to the U.S. and live with pre-selected and approved families. They would go to school, get jobs, and live in America in safety, no longer living in fear of being persecuted or taken back into slavery. This is my overall plan. Please help us. And I read it and I thought, oh, I really wish we were sitting down together to have this conversation. So I pulled my keyboard and I started typing to say, you know, it's a great idea, like pulling people out of slavery and pulling people out of oppression and giving them a place of safety is a beautiful idea. And I wholeheartedly applaud that. But it's not as easy as this. You can't just bring people from another country here. You have to go through a process of getting visas, and that's seriously complicated. We can't even get visas for everybody who wants to come to this conference, let alone people who want to come here to live. You can't just take somebody who's gone through serious trauma and plop them in with a family who may not have any training in how to help people who've gone through trauma. And immigrants are one of the most at-risk groups for being trafficked in the U.S. So bringing an immigrant here does not necessarily ensure their safety. So I wrote a super long email, and I haven't heard back, because I think what she wanted was an easy answer. Like, oh, let's just go rescue people and pull them off the street. And I wish it were that easy. It's just not. It's a super, super complicated. It's a super complicated issue that's rooted in a deep, deep darkness. So as a church, what can we do? Governments, high-level governments, the State Department, they talk about the four P's of human trafficking: prevention, protection, prosecution. The current administration added partnership as one of those. As a church, I think we should add a fifth one. So the fifth P is prayer. In the next workshop, Jennifer's going to go much more in depth into some of these strategies and how to involve whole communities and different groups of people. We're going to breeze through some of that right now just as an introduction, but we will go much more into depth in this in the next workshop. I'm going to park in the first one of prevention and remind us that prevention is action. It's not as exciting as going somewhere and pulling somebody off the street. It's not. But wouldn't it be great if trafficking never happened? Wouldn't it be great if, as the church, we could step in and stop that from happening to somebody? Stop it before it starts. And I think the church is very, very well equipped at the prevention piece. And it's super important. It's something that sometimes we don't think about when we talk about anti-trafficking. We think about protection and prosecution. But the prevention piece is hugely important, and it's something that the church is equipped and called to do. So why? Why does human trafficking happen? It's an important question to answer before you start thinking about what solutions might be. So there's a push-pull. So I live in a town with lots of cliffs. So when we think about the push factor, I think about somebody teetering on the edge of a cliff. What's that thing that easily pushes them over? What's that thing that makes them vulnerable standing on the edge of the cliff that they can easily be pushed over? Then the pull factor. It's more like, what is that game, the tug of war? When you have a rope and somebody's trying to pull you over. So that's a little more intentional. And it's a little more intentional. But that push factor is those vulnerabilities. I'm going to ask, I'm going to call out a few people that I know in here and just ask, what are the things that make people in your communities vulnerable in general? Stephen, would you mind? Stephen Phillips is from South Africa and is now currently working in Senegal. Would you mind just sharing a little bit, what are some of the things that make people in Senegal vulnerable? What do you mean by the worldview?
How society, how country views children.
Children?
Yeah.
What about, is there a specific way that girls in particular are viewed in that culture?
There's a large Muslim population as well. Mm-hmm. There's also women are viewed in that country.
Yeah. Jay? Would you speak, this is Jay Sundberg, who lives in Central Europe. Would you speak a little bit into how, specifically the refugee crisis right now, as people are coming through Central Europe, how that makes them vulnerable?
Well, I think generally maybe a lack of access to opportunities would be a general one, but for the refugees, I think it's just desperation and vulnerability. And lack of understanding, they have a goal and someone's gonna provide that goal and they have no idea if that's a good person or a bad person, so lack of information. So those things, I think, are happening, and it, through the refugee crisis, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of missing children. They don't know where they are, and they find dead children. So it's just they are just very vulnerable, desperate people, and people see it as an opportunity to take advantage of them.
Sure. Yeah. Anybody else? What are some specific vulnerabilities in the places where you live? What makes people vulnerable? The story of Crystal that we showed earlier, I don't know if you caught that. She said when she was 8 years old, she was raped every day by her stepfather. A huge percentage, and I don't have the number off the top of my head, but it's something like 80, 90% of victims and survivors of sex trafficking were abused in some way as children. That's huge. And it is something that we as the church can address. And Stephen talked about poverty, and again, I want to emphasize that's not the story for every single victim of trafficking, but it is a huge part of the story around the world. I have a niece who is 17, and she's volunteering this summer with a friend of ours who works with an organization in Rwanda, and so she sends out these little weekly sort of updates of what I'm learning to people who help support her. And she talked about meeting a group of girls who were 19, 20. They were all single mothers of young children. And their story went that they wanted to pay for school because they wanted opportunities in the future. They didn't have money. Their parents didn't have money. So they had transactional sex so that they could pay for school. And then they got pregnant and got kicked out of school. And their lives now, they have small children and no education and not a lot of hope for the future. It's not like they woke up one day and said, this is what I want to do. Desperation pushed them over the edge of that cliff. And that story is around the world. And it's why refugees coming through are vulnerable to promises of, I have a great job for you. Lots of people fall victim to that story because they're desperate and they need to believe that there is something better out there. The pull factors, let me talk a little bit about the foster care system too. Again, statistics, you know, you can read different statistics in different places, but something like 60, 70% of victims of trafficking, specifically sex trafficking in the U.S., came through the foster care system or some sort of state welfare system. It's a huge push factor. Runaway and homeless youth, which actually ties into this one. A lot of LGBTQ youth wind up homeless because they were kicked out, and they're highly, highly vulnerable to trafficking. Childhood sex abuse, which we've talked about, physical or mental disabilities, for immigrants, lack of identity papers, ethnic minorities, people from dysfunctional homes. There's a book, and please don't buy it. Please don't buy it. But it's called Pimpology. And a guy wrote basically how to pimp people. And he says, you'll start to dress her, think for her, own her. If you and your victim are sexually active, slow it down. After sex, take her shopping for an item. Hair, nails are fine. She'll develop a feeling of accomplishment. She'll start to crave intimacy. After you've broken her spirit, she has no sense of self-value. Now, put a price tag on the item you've manufactured. Then he says, I'm walking through the mall. I go up to a girl who's probably with her friends, maybe walking behind them, and say, hey, honey, you're beautiful. If she agrees and looks me in the eye, I keep going. If she looks down, says, you think so? I know I have her. As the church, are we telling young women and young men that you are people of value? You are made in God's image. Is that something as the church that we can do? You are a person of value. You are made in God's image. You are loved by God. The dysfunctional homes, that's something we as the church can address. And sometimes we're so busy thinking about the big issue and the big statistics, 21 million. And we're not looking around at the people in our church, the children in our church, the youth in our church who might be being abused. That's something as a church that we can do. So what fuels trafficking and makes it profitable? The sex industry, which with the internet, man, it's huge and exploding. Technology makes it easy. As far as labor trafficking goes, the demand for cheap goods, I want that shirt for $5. Somebody didn't get paid very much to make that shirt if it cost $5. Cultural attitudes, which is what Stephen talked a little bit about. How do we view girls and women? How do we view people who are ethnic minorities? You know, how do we view people who are different from us? Again, we're going to talk more about this in the next session, but just some ideas for prevention that churches can be involved in. Can you do a ministry for foster care youth? When youth age out of foster care, can you provide a place for them? Awareness, education, Bible studies, teaching parents about online safety, ministry with at-risk groups. This is a sort of simple, I'm sort of simple when I think about strategies. What are the needs in your community? What are the gifts and abilities in your church, and where do those things line up? So just a simple question, which is, what is your piece of the puzzle? We can't all do everything. So what is your piece of the bigger puzzle? And Jason's going to go a little bit into that, into some ways to think about that in different contexts.
So is there anyone that's good at drawing things in the room? If you raise your hand, don't worry, you won't be called on. Just kidding, you will. Please, someone. Anyone? Because you're going to end up with my drawing, and that's not going to be pretty. No one? Okay. Yes. Okay, great. Thanks. While she's doing that, we're going to go ahead and watch a video.
This is Anna. Wait, don't click to someone else yet, because Anna's stuck here on your computer screen. And while you can walk away, her image is stuck on the internet. See, your fantasy is Anna's nightmare. There's a good chance recruiters lured her with flattery. Perhaps they baited her with cash. Maybe they even tranquilized her with date rape drugs. And if Anna's like many others, she stays sedated with alcohol, weed, or coke to numb the pain. Chances are she faces STDs and HIV because she's denied access to protection. We don't know what she's been through because we only see Anna smiling. And they keep showing Anna smiling so that you'll keep watching. See, pornography is integral to human trafficking and prostitution. In 9 countries, almost half, 49%, said that pornography was made of them while they were in prostitution. This generation fights sex trafficking more than anyone ever has, and more than anyone ever has, this generation consumes porn. Fighting human trafficking and then watching porn is like protesting a corrupt politician and then donating to his campaign. You browse privately, going from Anna to Zoe and back to Anna. Watch your favorite fantasy and then walk away. But Anna's still there. She's stuck there, stuck in this life because you click. Each click, each link, each URL visit and play button, this is the currency of porn. This is the price of Anna's life. The $100 billion pornography industry is fueling the appetite for children as well. Teenage girls now make up the biggest slice of viewable porn, which by definition is considered trafficking. The demand for porn fuels the trafficking industry, and you can take away that demand. You can cut the cord on this machine. You can bankrupt the system. You can empty the pimp's pockets. You can free Anna by simply refusing to click.
So I wanted to show this video on pornography. Like I mentioned before, that I worked with churches for quite a while before I started working internationally. I worked with churches in the U.S. And for years. I started that in 98, so for years I did that. And every year we used to have a pornography campaign. Annually it was sent out to our churches with materials, you know, do a sermon, have Bible studies every year. And it focused on the moral basis of not doing pornography, and in some ways it created this mindset about the pornography campaign that it was like rules based, and not that the curriculum was bad, and if you helped write that, I'm not saying anything was bad with the curriculum. It probably wasn't, but it just, that was the construct that got in people's minds, so that now when you start to talk about moral issues and individualize that, like doing right and wrong, whether it's good or bad, then it loses some of its community connotation. And so when we're thinking about pornography as it relates to human trafficking in churches, as it relates to how we help to impact our communities, I feel like there maybe is a need for rebranding, rebranding our approaches on fighting pornography, and also understanding its implications on a deeper, in a deeper way. So one of the things that we're going to look at, and what's your name? What is it?
Ashling.
Okay. Ash, thank you so much for this. She's just going to draw this root cause analysis piece on the whiteboard here, so we can fill it in a little bit. But this is one tool out of a whole process, right? So again, this is an introduction. We'll do this, but there could be a whole class, a whole semester-long class taught on doing root cause analysis, possibly. I feel like it's maybe a helpful learning tool for us just to start thinking through the idea of things are related and how things like pornography could impact trafficking. So I'm going to ask for participation. Wow, it's quick. The right person. Right person on the bus. So we'll just wait for 1 second here, and we'll go ahead and do that. The issue that we're going to deal with is the Freedom Network, through the Wesleyan Holiness Alliance, has been working on a project in the Philippines for a couple of years. And there was a report. Thank you so much, Ash. Appreciate it. A report done just to analyze the needs in the Philippines. And what they found was that there's a growing online child sexual exploitation process taking place within the Philippines, where vulnerable children from impoverished communities are going online and are being taken online by traffickers. And it's a live feed. And so people in the US, people in Europe, people in Asia are paying to go onto that live feed and to basically say, I want them to do this. And then the children have to act out whatever what they paid for. And it's a very difficult process to prosecute, as you could imagine, to even find out where it's taking place. But I wanted to use that as our issue as we're thinking through that. So we would probably write the issue right here. So I'm just going to say online child sexual exploitation in the Philippines. And then we're going to come down here to these branches, and we're going to ask about what kind of underlying cause. And since I've already started us out, I'm going to take one of these main branches here and call it pornography. Does everyone agree that that could be a main cause? So the way this works, see if I can walk you through a quick example. There's a thing called the five whys. It's almost like a child that's under five We're going to the zoo. Why? Well, we're going there because there's animals. Why? Well, because you love animals. Why? I don't know, because you're my child. You go until you get to a stopping point, basically. It doesn't have to be five whys. That's just an idea that lets you know don't stop where you normally do. So if pornography is a cause, why is pornography a problem? What is a cause of pornography? Demand for pornography. So, sorry, I can't talk upside down. So, why is there a demand for pornography? Lust. Can we do why is there lust? We could try that. Anybody have a why is there lust? Yeah, I think we can probably stop that one there. And then unhealthy relationships. Why are there unhealthy relationships? There is a circle there, right? There is a circle there. Addictions.
Broken families.
Yeah.
Broken families are also a part of the cause for healthy relationships.
Previous abuse.
And that could even be even off of broken families, right? Because that could cause broken families. So, as you know, these relationships, there's different places it doesn't have to go through broken families that previous abuse would impact. But you start to see how you can diagram out and get a picture of underlying causes. Let's go up here. What are some of the effects? So these children, you know, They've gone through this. Let's say they were there for 5 years, experiencing this, or whatever. What are some of the effects that would take place after experiencing online child sexual exploitation?
Severe psychological trauma.
I think those are probably two effects. So we probably could go physical. Because the person has become transactional. They've been commodified, and then the way that they respond out of that.
It's always transactional.
I mean. We should probably say depression, maybe. So you say murder? Uh, Okay, so you're cooking. So we're getting ideas here. So once you've mapped out these pieces, and I hope you're beginning to see how this could be helpful, because then you can take this type of diagram and you can start to see how this is a system of issues that has to be dealt with. And actually, let me go maybe. So you might ask the question, which of these causes can we work on together as a community? I think that was the other piece I may have brought into the Samaritan woman's story, was how everyone is linked together, even if you're talking about a person that seems to be marginalized. The effects of her salvation ended up impacting the whole community. And so that there are effects that impact. In fact, when we did this, we may should have even said, what are the effects for the perpetrators? What are the effects for their families back in the States as well? I mean, there's other stuff. So there could be issues that churches in the States are working on. There, people could go to jail for that. So maybe if they get caught, I hope they will. But maybe there's a prison ministry there. So you can begin to look at these needs and issues. It can be used with different community groups, so law enforcement, government officials, healthcare providers, women, men, youth, church leaders, other organizations. And as you start to look at your tree, you might say, I don't even know where we wrote it here, but health issues have come, physical health issues have resulted out of this. So how can we partner with the local clinic? How can we partner with a hospital or a doctor that's volunteering their time? Or legal issues. Do we have strong enough laws? Why can't we prosecute this? Aftercare issues, counseling issues. They're all there, and you can begin to think about what type of program. So maybe even working off of the letter that you receive, as you start to analyze this, then the next step, you can start to say, well, maybe this is a role that I can play, and who else are already doing things in our community.
So that's a lot of, am I on? That's a lot of information, and we want to save time for some question and answer at the end. But I'm passing out a sheet of resources, all kinds of sort of next steps for research, thinking, things that you can take back to your churches. But I do want to mention a few specific ones. If you go to ncm.org/trafficking, there's a resources button that has all kinds of stuff there. Hours and hours of research that I've done, organizations that I think are quality, research that I think is good. So that's a resource that you can go to for additional sort of ponderings on your own, thinking through your community, your context, and things that you can spur your church on to action. The Church of the Nazarene, through Nazarene Compassionate Ministries, is a member of FAST, the Faith Alliance Against Slavery and Trafficking. That website is full of free downloadable resources, Bible studies, prayer activities that you can do with your church, all kinds of things. There's a church toolkit, a community toolkit, and a school toolkit, I believe. And they'll all have great stuff, but there's specifically a church toolkit for churches. The Church of the Nazarene, through Nazarene Compassionate Ministries, is also a part of the Engage Together Network. They also have some free downloadable resources. I have a copy here. This book comes as a free downloadable resource. And it's basically step by step taking a church through how do you move from understanding to a plan of action. They also have, and it's not free, unfortunately, but they have a DVD teaching series that will take a church through these steps. If you look at this book and you go, well, what do I do with this, and how do I take this to my church? They do have a DVD series that takes you through it. And if that's something, I think it's $150, $200, and if you think, gosh, I'd really love to do that with my church, we just don't have the budget for that, email me and we'll talk and we'll figure out how to help you access what you need to move your church to action. Questions? Oh, good question. So you can get to me at B as in Beth, Luthye, at Nazarene.org. And you can always just email info@ncm.org, and somebody will forward it to me. So what questions do you guys have? I would rather not say, but it was a person.
Okay, from a person. That could have kind of bored me, because I think sometimes God will give somebody a vision that is super simplistic and simplified in a heart to see that. And then, or at least I should speak for myself. I think the initial call God put in my heart was super simplistic. And it wasn't until I started taking the journey forward that he unfolded.
No, I agree.
But I think it's important to say it's okay to be at a simplistic understanding place, or that it's okay that if this is your heart and you don't quite yet know how that's going to happen.
No, I agree. And I did actually end my email back to her with lots of resources and to hear ways that you can find other people in your community, and please let me know if you want to continue this conversation. So I didn't just shut her down. But no, I absolutely agree. Vera, do you mind if I call you up? Vera works with an organization called, Rest Stop Ministries, thank you, which was birthed out of First Church of the Nazarene in Hermitage, Tennessee. So Pastor Rondi Smith was part of this church, and her experience is exactly the same as what you described. Just a, I know I need to do something. She'll also talk about the process that it took for a church to birth a restoration home for trafficking survivors. 4 years. And so I guess what I would say is, if you're committed to something, absolutely, jump in feet first. Bring people alongside you. Ask questions of experts. And for the people who say, well, this is too hard, I didn't know it would be this hard. Well, you know, maybe those are not the people who are going to wind up at that spot down the journey that you talked about. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
What was the young lady's name you just mentioned that for the Rest Stop Ministries?
Well, this is Vera, who works at Rest Stop Ministries, but Rondi Smith is the director of that ministry. So she resigned as pastor so that she could do this new ministry. Yeah.
So our compassion ministry is in partnership with an organization called Restore Hope that rescues and works with our local law enforcement of human trafficking. But the issue that we had was with our church, that if we had something like that so close to our church building, they started being concerned about their children. Okay. And so how do you, is there materials that kind of show statistics or help to alleviate that concern?
Yeah, I guess I would say, can you encourage your church to do some thinking about how to minister to people? You know, forget about what time it meets or whatever, but how can you encourage those parents to reach out? FAST has a curriculum called Hands That Heal that goes much more in depth into how do you work with survivors? How do you do trauma-informed care? There are resources online for trauma-informed care for churches. I would say that would be a great starting point. You know, talk to church leaders to say, how can we as a church be better about ministering to people who've experienced trauma of all kinds, whether it's seen or unseen, and then, you know, step into specifically this form of trauma. And then I would go to that fifth P of prayer. Yeah.